So, an 8-year-old male from Mangaluru, accompanied by his mother, a reliable source of informant, presented on 10th of March 2022 with chief complaints of difficulty in feeding since birth, stiffness in all four limbs since 6 months of age, absence of milestones. The history will be presented from birth since the problem started then. Antenatal history. The child was first born out of a third degree consanguineous marriage. The couple conceived spontaneously when the mother was 23 years old. The pregnancy was uneventful with regular visits in all trimesters. All scans were normal and there is no history suggestive of infections. Ma'am, should I read the antenatal history all because it is nothing?
You present the history completely. Okay, yes. Then we will go back and
We'll do like examination. You complete the history. Whatever you feel is relevant, wherever you want to stress, you spend more time. Others, okay, if you want to grossly like a summarization, you can do. That is also fine.
Sure, sir. First trimester, pregnancy was detected by UPT and confirmed by ultrasound. There is no history of fever or rashes. Iron and folic acid tablets were taken. The first dose of TT injection was also taken. There is no history of exposure to drugs or radiation. Second trimester, quickening was felt in the 5th month. There is no history of fever, rashes, headache, blurring of vision, polyuria or polydipsia. Ultrasound did not show any anomalies. Iron and folic acid and second dose of TT were taken. Third trimester, fetal movements were well appreciated. There is no history of headache, fever or blurring of vision. Ultrasound was normal. Iron and folic acid tablets were taken regularly. Natal history. The child was born on 17th of March 2014 at 9 months of pregnancy. He was delivered after an emergency LACS was performed after the membrane ruptured when the mother was on the way to the hospital for labor pain. Postnatal history. The birth weight of the baby was 2.5 kg. The baby did not cry immediately after birth. There is history of seizures soon after birth. The baby was then admitted to NICU for 25 days. The timing of first passage of meconium and stool is not known. The baby was fed with expressed milk until discharge from NICU. There is no history suggestive of neonatal jaundice. The baby was exclusively breastfed until 3 months after the discharge and breastfeeding continued till 1 year. Feeding problem manifesting as regurgitation and reduced feeding were noted then. History of presenting illness. The family members began to notice stiffness in all limbs of the baby when he was 6 months old, which has been increasing gradually to his current posture. Subsequently, they also noticed that the baby is not learning to roll over, sit, stand, walk or speak as other children of his age do. Currently, the child is bedridden and dependent on the caretaker. He cannot perform any voluntary movements, including lifting his head or turning over the bed. He cannot reach objects. The range of passive movements is also reduced. He cannot chew food and regurgitates on swallowing. And she is on a semi-solid diet. There is history of drooling of saliva. The child neither speaks nor alerts to speech nor does he smile back when smiled at. He responds only to pain and occasionally to loud sounds. He is on diapers since birth. There is history of recurrent episodes of fever with cough since birth, 2 to 3 episodes a year, which relieves on medication. There is no history of subsequent seizures, involuntary movements, or head trauma. Treatment history. The informant is unaware of the treatment baby received in the NICU. Since the discharge, the child has been on some medications taken every day. During the episodes of fever and cough, the child takes drugs for the said symptoms. There is no history of hospital admission or physiotherapy treatment. Developmental history. Gross motor, neck holding not attained. Impression. Developmental age less than 3 months. Fine motor, bidextrous reach is absent. Developmental age less than 4 months. Language. Does not alert to sounds. Developmental age less than 1 month. Social and adaptive, no social smile. Developmental age less than 2 months. Impression, global developmental delay affecting all domains development. No milestones have been achieved. Immunization history, the child is immunized for age as per the national immunization schedule. Last session was held when the child was 5 years old. Family history, the child was born to a third couple with a third degree consanguineous marriage. Diet history, there is a calorie deficit of approximately 650 kilocalories and protein deficit of 8 grams. they belong to lower middle class. Summary, an 8-year-old male has global developmental delays with no milestone issue, difficulty in feeding.
Can you summarize?
Limb stiffness and recurrent QRT. The child developed birth asphyxia and seizures following an emergency anesthesia, which prompted a 25-day NICU stay. Born in a lower middle class family out of a third degree concerned in his marriage, he is immunized for age but undernourished.
Okay. Go back to your first slide.
Okay, see, basically you are dealing with a child who is developmentally delayed. But whenever a parent comes, they'll come to you with a presenting complaint. Okay, so this child is having problem from 8 years. Okay, you have constructed the history in such a way, but what was the current problem for which she came to the hospital? What was her presenting complaint?
They had gained basically
fitness, all these things have been there.
Since
correct?
Birth from is years what together. You have presented, right?
Unless you have called them for examination or something where she had no problem. Sometimes they call for examination. Any such thing? What actually brought her to the hospital?
No, that patient came for receiving physiotherapy treatment.
Okay. I have come to you for a specific complaint. First, you have to address that. Otherwise, you can make a statement. This is a child with having all this, problem in this chronological order. Presently, the child came to the physiotherapy, for a physiotherapy session, during which time we have taken the history. Okay. So that is the thing.
Yes.
So when you are dealing with a case of global developmental delay, what is your aim of history taking? In fact, in general, what is your aim of history taking?
Okay, sir's question was, what is the purpose of taking a history in such a child? What do you think? Anybody can answer.
I'm asking a very, very basic question, but it is important.
To know the cause of CP. Okay, then anything else? You decided that this child was a cerebral palsy case. Okay, if not for cerebral palsy.
Look for, since when it is there.
So the type of cerebral palsy you want to know. Then.
The thing is, basically, because we have a short time, I think we will get on, because the purpose is to learn. Okay, so the thing is, basically, you have to get a diagnosis. Okay, so diagnosis, what are the components? Okay, so we have to know where is the problem, that is the anatomy. What is the problem? What exactly is the problem? That is the pathology. Then what is causing the problem? That is the etiology. Then what are the associated complications? If you address these things, then we can manage the child. So any purpose of any history taking is this. So whenever you are presented with this particular complaint, you have taken history, you have to make sure that all these issues are addressed. Okay.
Yes, so I think people have mentioned the differential diagnosis and any treatable cause. Yes, good thought.
Okay, so here you are dealing with a case of global developmental delay. So first, for that, what is the first question you have to answer? You have to make sure that the child is a case of developmental delay. So when you say developmental milestone is delayed, what that clarity we should have. When do you say developmental milestone is delayed? Rather than typing, you can,
I think you can unmute and answer as well.
Yeah, okay. Somebody has messaged DQ less than 70. Okay, so for that, we need to know what is DQ. Okay, so can anybody tell me what is DQ? Same person, maybe.
Developmental question.
Yes, tell me what is a developmental quotient.
What do you understand by that?
It is the
age of... Yes. Usha, yes, we're answering, yes.
The age at which the milestone is attained by the chronological age.
Into 100. That means 100. It is supposed to attain at a particular age, whether it is on par with that age. If it is delayed, how much it is delayed percentage wise. You want to take percentage wise, that is, it is 100.
Yeah, that is one way of assessing. The other thing is also to say, if the child has not attained age appropriate milestone less than the standard deviation, okay, two standard deviation, then because every milestone has a range, okay, so every child might not attain a head control at a particular point. So that is why we do have standard deviation charts. If a particular milestone is not attained at that particular age, so less than two standard deviation, then also we decide that it is a developmentally delayed child. Okay, that is the point. Okay, next.
So that is the first concept. I think that concept is clear. Okay, so first you have to be sure developmental delay either with DQ or the standard deviation. Okay, for this you have to do.
So that means to say now we are sure this child is having developmental delay. That part is sure for all of us. Okay, what is the next thing you want to address?
So the child is developmental delay. What is the next thing you want to know?
Whether it's global developmental delay.
Yes, very good, very good. Okay, yeah. So what do you mean by global developmental delay?
It should involve more than two domains.
Okay, I will say it is gross motor and fine motor are delayed. Do you say it is developmental gross?
No, ma'am. Gross and fine motor gross are only and fine one, are domain. One domain.
Okay, so good.
So two or more domains. Motor is taken as one. Okay, then you have social milestone, language milestone. So this child definitely has got a global developmental delay. But for approach sake, if it is independent, what do you think? We'll just discuss briefly and go. Suppose one child is only predominantly having gross motor milestone delay, another is having predominantly social milestone delay, another child is having predominantly language delay. So what do you think in these scenarios? Here it is not the case. We'll just touch upon and we'll come back to global delay.
If it is predominant motor delay, what are the causes? What do you think? Because see, I presume this is Srivatsa is an undergraduate. We just want the basics to be straight and then we want to proceed.
Others okay? also can answer. Yes, please pitch in. We are not making him the scapegoat. Okay, you can help your friend.
What do you think if it is only motor delay?
It could be neuron or lower motor neuron.
Okay, like? Lower motor neuron like? What are the causes? Isha?
Some postgraduates are also there here.
Yes, some postgraduates are also there.
You can pitch in.
Local causes because of any spinal issues, ma'am. Is there any hypotonia which is causing?
So you will become motor unit problems. Okay, that itself is a separate issue. We will not get into that. Motor unit would include
everything. Somebody told LMN, yes, it is either myopathy, neuropathy, or at a spinal level, whatever may be the level. So most of the times, it is the motor unit issue which causes the specific gross motor delay most of the times. Okay. Yeah.
If it is predominantly social, what do you think?
Yes, okay. Autistic spectrum of disorder, you want to think. Okay, yes, okay, yeah. Then?
If it's predominantly language? What is the first thing you want to rule out? You want to first think of treatable causes? No.
Hearing defect.
Yes, got it. Simple things. Okay. Yes.
Now we'll come back to global developmental delay. It's just that in the broader circuit you should fit. So you should know. Now here definitely. So your case is very easy because he has not attained any milestones. There is no differences. No,
I want you to just share the screen. I want you to go to that first slide. I have few clarifications. I want to ask you the doubts because I think there are two people who already have seen. Can you go to the first slide?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, in your first slide, you chose difficulty in feeding as your first complaint. Is there anything specific? Then you told it is stiffness in all four limbs and absence of milestones.
Difficulty in feeding, you have to elaborate, no?
Yeah, why did you choose and... Difficulty in feeding is what you have chosen as one of your chief complaints. Okay.
Yeah.
Why did you choose?
And what exactly is the thing? What are all the problems which have caused difficulty in feeding?
Let us come to each chief complaint and then assess. Okay. Why did you choose it is difficulty in feeding? What are the causes of difficulty in feeding?
Because you ask any mother, no mother will tell it's easy to feed my child. Every child is difficult to feed for every mother. So what exactly you mean by difficulty in feeding here?
Can you elaborate on that?
You have elaborated. No, same thing we're asking you to repeat so that we will know what is causing.
After birth, there was, the baby was fed after it was. But then the parents.
Even so, your voice is not very clear. Can you remove that earpiece?
Remove your speak and ear. See?
Clarity illa.
No, without earphones, you try to speak. not possible.
Please remove your earphones and then just use the computer speaker.
You're using laptop only, right?
Yes, it is.
Yeah, you remove your earphone. Remove your earphone and speak.
No, no, public. That's the problem.
We can't hear anything.
We can't hear you at all. Okay.
Others can hear, or is only our problem?
No, so none of us can hear problem.
Others are also having problem. Okay, others can answer. See, what he has already given some details. What do you think is the problem?
Go to the next slide where you have described difficulty in feeding.
Difficulty in feeding can come because of so many reasons. No. So you can have local lesions. Okay, a child who is having.
What are the possible causes of difficulty in feeding?
Pseudobulbar palsy.
Okay. If not for a CNS cause, is there anything else? Because we are yet to decide that this child is having issues. Okay, so what you said was right. If this is a child with cerebral palsy or a developmental delay, if there is nothing, can there be any issues with difficulty in feeding?
Corneal ectasia, CHD, any?
Yes. Then? Yes, ulcers. So there could be local causes, as all of you are saying, or there could be an anatomical abnormalities, as congenital issues can
cleft
be there.
Cleft palate can be there.
Yes, yes. Okay. Yes.
Because of sucking difficulty.
Yes. Okay. So there are different phases of swallowing. Okay. Or there could be issue with your oral phase. Okay. There could be an issue with pharyngeal phase or an esophageal phase. In any of these phases, the swallowing difficulty can arise. Okay, first and foremost, rule out the local causes. Then you rule out any anatomical defects are there, and probably then you take a decision. The nerve supplied by those structures, if it is abnormal, then you will decide if it is a lower motor palsy or an upper motor palsy. Then probably whoever said it's pseudobulbar palsy will also come into picture. Okay. So that will be the approach for a difficulty in feeding, right?
So what made you decide it is neurological? It is decided it is neurological problem because difficulty in feeding alone, I'm asking.
Srivatsa, you are able to follow us?
Just a minute, ma'am.
Yeah.
Others can answer. What made you think that the difficulty in feeding is neurological is the question. So we discussed so many things now. Of all the things, has he given clear-cut history from where you can decide that it is because of the neurological problem?
Okay, difficulty in swallowing then? Because there is spasticity.
No, I'm asking only regarding difficulty in feeding. We will not go to spasticity as of now. He has given history, no. There is pooling of secretions. Okay, so pooling of secretions tells you that there is a cranial nerve palsy. Okay, that itself gives you a clue. Anything else, if it is present, is a history which can tell you. Hypophonia. Okay, if the kid is having hypophonia, that straight away takes it to neurological. Okay, so that history, anyways, because this child is almost developmentally zero, it is difficult to appreciate. So, pooling of secretions. That puts it in neurological case. Okay. Then after your other things, when you extend that spasticity, you know, no developmental milestones, all those things will come into play.
Srivatsa, you have settled?
Yes.
Okay.
Am I audible now?
Yes, yes.
Yeah, better.
Okay. You are better? Okay.
But he is not going to remove his earphones. He has decided.
Okay, yes. You tell us.
No, I'm in a public place. So if I remove it.
Okay, we got it. That was your first complaint. No, we are trying to dissect out each complaint, whatever you have told. Okay, we have arrived at difficulty in swallowing probably was a neurological cause. Okay, but anyway, what is your next complaint which you told?
Stiffening, correct?
Yes.
Yes.
Stiffness in all four limbs. How did you elicit the history?
No, they told they were not able to move his limbs, or he was not able to move his limbs.
Your advantage, disadvantage, both in this case is it is a very much full blown case. you'll have problems if it's an evolving case. Suppose this child was not a very frank case where, you know, you have all full stiffness, mother doesn't come out with this history. What specific questions you will ask to elicit stiffness? Suppose you're thinking it's a cerebral palsy. So one of the ways is to prove that is to ask for a history of stiffness. Okay, so that is a motor involvement. So how will you ask specific questions if mother doesn't come out with that history?
While changing any diapers and while dressing the child, is there any difficulty?
Changing diaper difficulty. What does that make you think? What is the problem? If she's finding it difficult to change diaper, what does it tell you?
Tone is increased.
Where?
Where?
Lower limbs.
Full lower limbs?
Lower limb is a very huge thing.
Full lower limb from thighs.
Specifically, she says, I cannot change the diaper. What specific groups of muscles we are asking?
Proximal muscles.
Which proximal? Again, proximal, you can have flexors, extensors, yes. Adductors, abductors.
Okay, adductors. Yes. Many so, of okay. you have answered as adductors. Yes.
Adductors. Okay, that is one thing. Okay, any other history like that we are asking. That is the calmness. Okay, adductor spasm is very well known. So that is a calmness thing. When they're doing day-to-day thing, that problem they're going to face. Any other history like that? If it is not full-blown picture like in your case. Many times, you know, it may not be that very
easy. It can be early rolling over. Early rolling over.
Early rolling over. What does that suggest?
That extensive.
Okay, extensive log rollover. What we call it as a log rollover. Okay, it is not a typical rollover where the child turns to one side and then takes off his hands. It is not a methodical. It is just like a log. There is a log rollover. That is something which you say as an advanced milestone when the child is less than what it expected. That is what I presume you are trying to tell us, right?
Okay.
Okay. Then somebody said early hand preferences. Okay.
Early hand preference doesn't tell you about the tone. It tells you that the kid is having hemiplegia. Okay. So early hand preferences, how early? That also you should have clear line. When does hand preference come?
By 3 years.
3 years. So if a 2.5 year old is having hand preference, it's abnormal?
2 to 3 years, sir.
Early means we can tell it is 1 year old.
Okay, yes, in infancy, 12 months, okay.
Up to 18 months, okay. So, before that, sometimes they reach out with both. Preferably, definite hand preference is there before 18 months, it has to be abnormal, as they said. Okay, that tells you about the weakness. It doesn't tell, not necessarily a spasticity. Fine, so this is one thing, because if you don't find that classical history, you will have to dig in more detail and elicit that history. And somehow I'm not happy with that statement, absence of milestones.
If stiffness is there, what are the neurological causes which can cause stiffness? Where can the neurological lesion, anatomical lesions, how we decided for feeding of difficulty? We said there is local and then there are CNS causes. If you get a stiff limb, where could be the anatomy, microanatomy of the disease?
Most likely neuron lesion.
Pyramidal.
Upper motor.
Okay.
Then.
So UMN lesion. Okay. UMN is again a huge thing, starting from spinal cord to the cortex. So how do you localize further?
Anybody?
In this case, there is cognitive deficit involved as well. So,
okay, in this case, it could be different. Okay. Well, I'm just asking if there is a stiffness, what are all the possibilities?
If it's in the cortex, what do you find?
Pyramidal tract can pyramidal cause spasticity. Yes, extra pyramidal can also have spasticity or rigidity.
It is a rigidity.
Okay. Okay, then anything else can have stiffness, which can mimic, look like stiffness? Dystonias? There also there is stiffening, okay? So these are the things where you should think when there is stiffness, okay? It could be...
So where do you put the lesion now? Cortex, subcortex, internal capsule? brainstem.
If there is stiffness in all four limbs.
Can we put the lesion anywhere, or you still need more details? Somebody has listed out. I appreciate that. So many things. But where is it likely now?
No.
And why?
Like language, and it is more like internal cord.
ಏನ್ ಗೊತ್ತಾ ತುಂಬಾ ಕಷ್ಟ ಆಗ್ತಿದೆ ನಿಮ್ ಧ್ವನಿ ಕೇಳಕ್ಕೆ.
If you are presenting the case, you should have sat in a private place. Why you went to a public place?
Alla, can you try removing your earpiece? It's okay. We will see what happens.
Others can answer.
Yes, please do an internal capsule. Why, Priyanka? Why do you think it is? Few of you are saying, sir, please unmute and say. Why do you think it is cerebral cortex, or why do you think it is internal capsule? Or can internal capsule, if it is an internal capsule, what is, if all the four limbs has to be involved, what should be there?
Cerebral cortex, because there is involvement of higher mental functions also.
Okay, if there was no involvement of cerebral cortex, then higher mental function, then?
Okay, so you are telling higher mental functions are involved here, all four limbs are involved, so it's cerebral cortex. Then how do you explain the cranial nerves? He is having swallowing difficulty, no? You're getting my question? When do cranial nerves get involved? Here 9th, 10th nerves are involved, no?
Okay.
So that means...
Pseudobulbar palsy, brainstem. Okay.
That means, so there is a diffuse involvement. Okay, it is not a pinpoint lesion. There is a diffuse involvement. In what all cases diffuse involvement come, when we discuss the etiology, we will come back to that. Definitely, there is cortical involvement, there is brainstem involvement. So there is a diffuse extensive involvement at the cerebral level. Okay, so that is the conclusion that we make.
If fine? Not, there was no other issues. Even a cervical, if at all four limbs has to be involved, lesion, if it is, if you're thinking in lower motor, it should have been in a cervical cord level, right? So then only all four limbs are involved for you. Okay, what is the next thing? Srivatsa, you made a statement, absence of milestones. I'm curious and I want feedback from all of you here, PGs, UGs. Do you agree with the statement that there is absence of milestones?
Technically, you're not wrong, but what is a better way of putting it?
Yeah, okay, whatever it is. Will you agree, disagree? Srivatsa.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, absence of milestone andre eno. Delayed no milestone. No milestone. Okay, then.
That means you are sure he is not going to attain any milestone?
That no, is till now he has not attained any.
So, your proper wording should be delay in attainment of age appropriate milestones.
Yes.
Okay, so he may go on to attain. You don't know. You're not treating that child. No. This age group, okay, 8 years. Suppose it's a 1-year-old, 2-year-old, that may, you know, statement doesn't look very great and positive. Okay, so many examiners may not like.
No, that is also one point. I think, say, if a newborn is 1 year, now, as of now, you have seen the child, okay. What does the child respond to mother's noise, mother's voice?
No.
Does the child turn its head to one side?
No,
response to noise, anything, and anything is there?
Response to loud noise. We have seen, but not otherwise. If you clap or hit anything, and no.
Okay. So otherwise, okay, what you have taken is at 8 years. Okay. I presume every milestone has, say, it is, if it is a head control, imagine. Okay. The child has to lift, you have seen 6 weeks, 8 weeks, or 30 degree, 45 degree, 60 degree, and then there is a slight wobbling of the head, and then there is steady head control. For sitting also, child starts with the tripod sitting, okay? Then there is something called lateral propping, then child sideways propping, then child sits with support and can turn. So every milestone has a range, okay? I'm sure this child must have attained at least a few of it in 2 weeks, in 3 months, 4 months. After that, what happens if there is issues? I mean, this child has as other issues. What can contribute, which can delay and which can cause issues in a CP? There is some attainment of milestone.
So what she's asking is
secondary regression.
baby has attained milestones, it is losing the milestone. Would it still be CP or it is a junior regression? CP, we know it is a static insult, no? So can a CP child lose the attained milestones, is the question.
When contracture development occurred. Contractures.
Then?
So it's not neurological regression. It is secondary to the physical problems.
Sometimes then, what happens, the child would have attained few milestones and then there is severe spasticity of all the four limbs. Spasticity untreated can go on to develop contractures and then fixed flexion deformities, which are appearing like the child is progressing over a period of time or the child has not attained milestones. Okay. It probably because you have taken at 8 years, in detail, I didn't get a journey of this child. Okay. It is difficult for the parent also to remember small things. Okay. So I presume it is purely might not be alone developmental delay. There are super added factors which could have contributed to the your statement of not attained any milestones. Okay. Yeah.
So now next thing, once you have proven it's global developmental delay, you have to tell us whether it is static or progressive disease. Okay. Yes. Again, you have a full blown case that is different. Suppose in subtle cases, how do you decide whether it is static or progressive?
In static, the developmental quotient usually remains constant.
Does this child have a developmental quotient constant? You have come to a right point where we can ask you. Just why I discussed the previous thing is because of that. You tell me what do you mean by that statement? You made a very good statement. Tell me, what does that mean?
It is constant zero.
If there is static diseases, static disorders. Suppose at the age of 1, the developmental quotient is 40. At the age of 2 also, he will attain milestones. He might attain new milestones, but the developmental quotient will still be 40 only.
Yes, very good concept. Okay. What you're trying to say is in a cerebral palsy or any child, the insult is static. Okay. But the child can over a period of time attain newer milestones. But as per your history, you are saying child has not attained. So that means to say, what was the DQ at 2 years, 3 years, 4 years? It is gradually deteriorating. So does this mean this child is a neuroregressive child? Okay, the whole statement is that, right? In a neuroregressive child, the developmental quotient over a period of time deteriorates. So then I will tell you that because of your statement, I will put it as a neuroregressive child. Will you agree, not agree?
No, it is zero all the time. It is what he's telling.
Zero?
All the time.
I don't know. I think it should be zero. No milestones have been.
No. What is the confusion? I'll tell you. See, what is happening here is, see, suppose you have a child. Okay. Who is supposed to roll over. Say, he roll over at 6 months, but he has rolled over, say, at 1 year. Okay. So, what is the DQ of this child?
50%.
Okay. Suppose you see this child at 3 years. He still can do only rolling over. What is the DQ of this child?
Still 50% because he attained it at 1 year of age.
No. What is the DQ? What is the actual definition of your DQ?
He has not attained any further milestone. Okay. So you see, not 1 year. Mother says 1 year he rolled over. After that, no further milestones are achieved.
One pediatrician has documented at 1 year, as you said, 50%. Now you are the new pediatrician who is seeing that child. And you say he has attained only rollover at 1.5 years also. Then what will be your DQ?
He'll make it 20% or he'll keep at 50%. That is the confusion now.
Others can answer. We'll not ask only Srivatsa. What do you all feel? This child.
People got the confusion part, no? What I'm asking?
It will be 20%.
Each milestone, whatever you are taking DQ at the time of achievement of the milestone. Okay. Suppose this child started sitting at 2 years. Okay. So then what will be the DQ at that time? Whatever age it has attained. After that, it has not achieved new milestone. Okay. For each milestone, you will have to say a DQ. So the DQ for rolling over is 50%. DQ for standing what I meant was sitting, which was instead of 9 months, it has achieved at 2 years. That means it is less than 50%, 30%, 40%, whatever it comes. That means it is a kind of progressive disorder. You're getting the point, no? So even if it is achieving new milestone, it is still a progressive disorder. But say it has to sit at nine months, it sat at 18 months, it decays still 50%. That means it is a static disorder.
A static would mean it is a pathology or the insult is static, okay? And the other things are dynamic, okay? CP is still dynamic, okay? Here I presume whatever issues have happened is secondary to the other complications which the child has developed. Yes. Okay, rather than only the milestones. See, here there are a lot of other issues. As you have only mentioned, there is stiffness. That means to say there is some spasticity which was untreated over a period of time has developed into a lot more other things in this child. That is why there are the DQ is so less for this child. Okay.
This you have to be very clear, because sometimes it gives you a regressive feeling because the development, see, that child was walking. Because of the development of contracture, he may not walk. It doesn't mean he has regressed. It's because of secondary to contractures. This you should be open
then
to.
That term, what is that terminology called? Anybody? This is something called as a pseudo-regression. What are the causes of pseudo-regression?
Contractures.
Anything else? See, sometimes seizures itself can cause. Okay, so the DQ can go down. Okay, there are a few things which can cause pseudo-regression. This is probably something like a pseudo-regression.
Post-meningitis also, during the recovery phase, sometimes what happens for some period of time, they would have lost some milestone. Gradually, once trained, they get back those milestones. Okay.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Can we go to the slides?
So, here you have decided. Now, you have, it is CP or it is something else? Global development.
What are the points we just discussed? Can you summarize, Srivatsa, if you can summarize?
Can you say it as CP, or you want to still say keep saying global developmental delay, or you want to think of something else?
Since there is a history of birth asphyxia and ICU subsequent ICU admission, baby did not cry at birth, and there is also associated history of seizures. We see. So I think I can.
So you're sure if somebody doesn't cry at birth, you're sure it is, he is asphyxiated? Baby is asphyxiated?
No.
If a baby doesn't cry at birth, what will you think? And what is the essential criteria to say that baby is asphyxiated? This is important.
There are so many,
if you have attended deliveries, you'll know there are so many normal babies who don't cry vigorously. They just breathe normally and they're happy. Even though majority of the babies do cry, I'm not telling that babies don't cry, but suppose the mother has taken some sedatives because of the pain, okay, they have given some narcotics, okay, baby is otherwise fine, ping, heart rate is good, everything is good, only the cry is not vigorous, isn't it? After a short period of time, baby is going to improve. It doesn't mean baby is asphyxiated. To say baby is asphyxiated, what you should prove in your history?
Others also can pitch in.
This is very, very important. Otherwise, every baby not crying, you will say it is birth asphyxia.
Say there is a baby which has not cried, and after half an hour, 30 resuscitation, after half an hour, mother says the baby, mother fed the child. Okay. There is one more child whom you say the child has not cried, and the baby was not feeding well, and baby was shifted to NICU. Which one do you think has birth asphyxia? Okay. Yeah, we are getting a lot of people saying yes.
Cord blood acidosis.
Okay, yes.
The investigation, we want clinical.
Clinically.
NICU, I can simply keep the baby in the NICU. There are so many NICUs.
Cyanosis.
No, what is called? We do agree that apgars are 10 minutes less than 3. Yes. Okay, what does that mean? What does all that mean?
Advanced kids, okay. Giving so many advanced answers. Okay.
We are asking simple things. See, we are just trying to tell you that there is something called neonatal encephalopathy. What do you mean by that?
What do you understand by neonatal encephalopathy? You have to prove that there is neonatal encephalopathy historically.
Altered level of consciousness of the baby.
So, for that, you have to know what is the normal newborn behavior. What is the normal newborn behavior? first few hours.
Rise soon after
about 30 minutes, it can go to sleep.
Okay. Then?
So it cries vigorously at birth. Then it is awake for about 20-30 minutes. After that, it goes to sleep for about 2-3 hours. Then the cycle of feeding, sleeping goes on. This is a normal pattern. If you establish this normal pattern historically, it is, even if it is not cried, there is no bilirubin encephalopathy. Got the point? Neonatal encephalopathy. Okay, so this you have to prove. That is why, if you say baby did not cry, when did they put the baby to the breast? After that, what happened? All that is important. If the baby was put to breast, as madam said, in 1 hour and discharged on day 2, day 3, depending on what type of delivery it is, that means the baby is normal for all practical purposes.
Okay, sir, either excessive crying newborn, okay, on day 1, or an excessive sleepy, or a baby which is not sucking, definitely would mean there is neonatal encephalopathy. Okay. Will that all neonatal encephalopathy child, will it
develop cerebral palsy? The next question. Okay. First question, you proved, okay, there is a neonatal encephalopathy. Will all develop, or how will you further increase the risk of development of CP historically? First, you have established encephalopathy. Next is, how will you prove what other history you will take so that you will know that the risk is increased? You know Sarnath and Sarnath staging, HIE? Heard?
Sarnath and Sarnath HIE staging, are
you aware? Anybody has heard? PGs can come in. You heard at least?
Yes.
Not heard. Okay.
Oh, three stages. Somebody is answering. Okay, good. So what is the prognosis in each stage? You go back and read, Cloherty has given stage 1, 2, 3 are there. In stage 1, 100% kids become normal. There is no problem. In stage 2, 80% still do well. 20% only get into trouble. Stage 3, majority will get into trouble. So, historically, if we can prove that it is stage 3, then your chances of
correlating... Or a prolonged stage 2, where the seizures are there and subsequently child had other issues, then also there are issues, okay? See, what we are trying to say is this is only... Asphyxia is only an etiology, okay? Will that tell you that it is cerebral palsy? What is the definition of cerebral palsy?
It is a disease of motor tone and posture.
Okay, okay. So that means to say,
So there are few things which you have to say. One is that you have to prove that it is a disorder, motor disorder, where there is tone, posture is affected, which you have proved there is stiffness and things like that. Second thing is, it has to be a static insult. Okay, so the etiology where it points, you will have to point on that. Third thing is, it has to happen during the
growing brain
phase. So, till when the brain grows is the next question. Suppose a 20-year-old develops a head injury, he also becomes stiff. Will you call him cerebral palsy?
No, sir. Most of the brain development occurs within 1 year of age.
Okay. So, 1.5-year-old a child develops meningitis and becomes stiff. You call him cerebral palsy?
No.
So, within 1 year only it should happen.
After 2 years.
Yeah, okay. We can...
Okay, 2 or 3 years you can debate. Different answers are there. 80 to 90% of your brain development happens. Okay. So, 2 or 3, up to 3 also you can extend and take. So, that is why you got antenatal, prenatal causes, perinatal causes, postnatal causes. Okay. What majority of the cases are because of what cause? We keep blaming the guy, gynecologists and pediatricians keep blaming each other now. So, majority of the CPs are having what etiology? Prenatal, perinatal, or postnatal causes?
Prenatal.
Very good. So, majority have prenatal causes. Many a times it is multifactorial. Okay. If you to prove perinatal, that is why, we are trying to tell you all this. You have to prove there is encephalopathy. You have to prove the staging, what staging. So, staging means whether he had, as madam said, continued seizures, whether he had any multi-organ dysfunction, like he was ventilated, he had any coagulopathy requiring transfusions, any bleeding issues, or whether he went in for any, renal failure requiring peritoneal dialysis, things like that. So, if those histories are there, that is stage 3, that carries a poor prognosis. Okay. Then prematurity, of course. this child is a term baby, so you don't have to worry.
Just before we proceed, I just want you, hopefully you have understood, do you know any other causes of global developmental delay?
Other than CP.
Are there any causes where there could be global developmental delay?
Down syndrome.
Okay, then? So that means to say some chromosomal anomalies can cause. Okay, yeah, all whatever you people have listed, Downs, Turner, or whatever it could, it is genetic association. There are chromosomal anomalies. Then
syndromic is what it all means.
Okay, storage what disorders. Then
what else? You listed out so many for
metabolic disorders, neuroregressive disorders. Yes. So whenever you talk about a global, first and foremost in your history, you have to prove that it is a developmental delay. Then you will prove that it is global developmental delay. And then, okay, depending on what is the course, say if there is tone abnormality, there is posture abnormalities, or if there are few other things, probably you will come to conclusion in further histories. Only then can you say that it is a cerebral palsy. Okay, not all global, even Down syndrome can have some birth asphyxia. That does not mean that it will become a cerebral palsy. Okay, whatever. So it is not about the etiology. It is just an etiology what you were talking. Okay, a developmentally delayed child with an abnormality of tone and posture. Okay, with other things. I think, I don't know if you have spoken that in history. We will come back to that. Only then can you say it is a cerebral palsy. Okay, yeah. Go back to your histories.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Why did you take all antenatal, prenatal, we just discussed, just to make sure that the etiology, you were trying to dissect what was the etiology. Okay. Then, this is voluntary movement, cannot lift. Okay. Then, what is the next thing you have gone? Okay. What are the other things you should ask if this is a cerebral palsy child?
Comorbidities.
What are the comorbidities? What are the other associations which a cerebral palsy child can have?
They are subjected to like fractures, hip fractures, spine deformities.
Okay, deformities, agreed. Okay, hip deformities, it is agreed. Okay, not fractures. I think whatever you are trying to say is little abnormalities. Okay, yes. Then anything else they can have?
Learning disability.
Yes, learning
feeding difficulty.
Feeding difficulty, then
vision,
hearing, okay, failure to thrive, very good.
Then
undernutrition, overnutrition, constipation, UTA, aspirations, okay, you name the thing it can have.
Okay, so that means to say, once you have proved that it is cerebral palsy, next is you will look into all these things. One more important thing in a cerebral palsy is your hearing, vision, and size of the head. Okay. You could ask the parent also to say if the head size is apparently small, like compared to other. Okay. A size child with a microcephaly more likely to be a cerebral palsy child. Okay. Does this child have?
Yes, yes, ma'am. In examination findings.
Yeah. So if you can ask after going back, you could ask the parent also. Okay. One is dysmorphism also, or you can ask your head size also. Okay. Then there is the other things which you have to ask, like others have asked. Vision, hearing should be asked. Okay. Other, what are the comorbidities this child is having?
Child can see.
Can this child see?
Like, we don't know how to assess that. The direct and indirect reflection.
Is he following? Is he looking at light? Is he following the light? Because light.
No.
He doesn't follow.
Nick is also stiff. He cannot talk.
No. Does he follow light?
No. There is a movement of the eyes, but it is not like voluntary. It's just randomly.
No, blink. See, best thing is the blink reflex. No. Okay, that we will discuss.
Menace reflex.
Menace or a blink reflex. Okay,
what else you can ask? If there is nystagmus, searching nystagmus, there is a bizarre nystagmus in this child. That means it is not able to focus. Okay, so that child is more likely to be blind. So it can have multiple reasons. It can have glaucoma, it can have cataract, it can have cortical blindness. Okay, so if the CNS is damaged, especially in cases of hypoglycemia where there will be occipital injuries, it can have optic atrophy. So multiple reasons can be there. So vision, you have to assess. Okay, if these clues are there, it will tell you. It doesn't follow, it doesn't focus on the face, human face. Nystagmus is there. That will tell you most likely, you know, the child is having blindness. Hearing, you said only to very loud noise, it responds. So it is not deaf.
Response, not always, just sometimes.
Hmm.
Because when we voluntarily try to make sound, it never turned.
So it is deaf only.
Okay. Occasionally to loud
sound. Suppose consistently it responds to loud sound. Is it deaf or not deaf? It responds. Startle response is there. Cooker seat udiyutha edukolutha mago. History is there.
The threshold might be higher. So
only rules out profound deafness. Okay. So milder degrees, it doesn't rule out. So okay. You still have to evaluate. Because these are the things which are going to give quality to the child's life. So you have to address this. You're getting the point. No. Suppose yes, you can give some hearing aid. Child's speech will also improve. Interaction will improve. See, he is, you know, vision also. If there's a correctable cause, definitely, you know, it is definitely going to help. So these things matter.
Yes.
Okay. So can you methodically summarize? You have summarized. Okay, first and foremost, after CP, we told you to say it is all the other comorbidities you have to rule out, and other complications. Does this child have any other complications? What are the complications you expect
when it is bedridden? It's bedridden.
One is because this child is not able to swallow. What are the complications you are expecting if the child is not swallowing?
Recurrent pulmonary aspiration.
Okay, one is aspiration, micro aspiration. What can that lead to?
Recurrent infection, pneumonia.
Okay, recurrent infections, pneumonia. Then, if the child is not eating well, what is the first thing?
Failure to thrive.
Yes. Okay. So failure to thrive. So nowhere in your history that point was brought about. Okay. So probably you could include that also. Failure to thrive also has to be brought out in this child. Okay. Then anything else? One is we finished that. Any other complication? Because this child is, yes, somebody has written bed sores. Okay. Yes. Sores can be there. Then anything else?
Contracture deformities.
Yes. Contractures, deformities, spinal deformities. Okay, or other deformities could also be there. Any child beyond 5 years of age, you expect an orthopedic complications. Okay, more like you were trying to say hip issues, hip displacement, all this. Okay, so in your history, it should have come out. Okay, yeah. So in any, this is in particular to cerebral palsy. Okay, in particular, this child is having motor issues. Say this is a CNS case. Okay, what are the other things you will mention in any CNS case? What should your completion of the history should include?
Bladder ball involved.
Okay, then.
I mean, spinal examination. Okay.
Examination,
history.
So as a part of your CNS, say first and foremost, this is a CNS case. Okay. We have decided that this child has motor issues. Okay. So whenever you're completing a history, make sure you ask about all the cranial nerves. So that will be a methodical way of presenting. Okay. See, you have done hodgepodge. You have done a lot of things. You have put everything. So I am just trying to analyze your history. Okay. After you had proved that this was a developmental delay, this child is having motor issues, you can probably ask all the cranial nerve related issues. Okay. I would be keen on, because you mentioned only about the lower motor. Okay. Vision, hearing, everything is a cranial nerve. Okay. It could be a facial deformities or facial nerve involvement that could be there. Okay. Then if there's any involuntary or your, what do you say? Extrapyramidal symptoms. Okay. If this child is having other movement.
No involuntary movements.
Yeah, that is why. It should come in your history is what I'm trying to say. And then sensation. If it is in any other case, sensation, what happens to your sensory involvement? As somebody has mentioned, bladder, bubble, all that will complete the examination. Okay. Yeah. So can one of you summarize this child and give us a proper diagnosis? Can Usha summarize?
he has given a good history and he has got a very simple and easy case because it is full blown.
Usha, can you add on to this? Can you summarize?
8-year-old male child, first born to a non-consanguineous parent, has a history of
third degree consanguinity, no?
Third degree consanguineous marriage. Is having a significant history of birth asphyxia. Yeah.
Significant perinatal asphyxia.
Perinatal asphyxia with global developmental delay.
What type of CP is this? Global developmental delay with all four limbs are involved. That means to say what type of CP?
If all four limbs are involved, what are the different steepest possibilities?
Yes.
Quadriplegic.
Only quadriplegic CP has all four limbs involved?
So there are tumor with upper limb, predominant upper limb involvement, predominant lower limb involvement. I'm not able to recall the names.
Those who can recall can tell. What happens in diplegia?
Both upper limb and lower limb, but lower limb is more involvement than upper.
So yes. Diplegia also, all four limbs are involved, but lower limbs are more involved. Okay. But diplegic generally have a better mentation. Okay. So if you have a poor mentation, historically you're not sure which limb is more involved, then you're more likely to be dealing with quadriplegia. If you're dealing with a better mentation, then you're more likely to be dealing with a spastic diplegia at the history level. What else?
What else? This is a spastic quadriplegic, probably a spastic quadriplegic cerebral palsy. Anything else to add on?
You're sure it is only perinatal asphyxia or any other causes? Area, multifactorial. Because we don't want to blame our colleague. They give us, you know, babies.
There is no history of prenatal any issues. There is no hyperbilirubinemia or history of hypoglycemia as such.
Postnatal things are there. Okay, postnatal things are there. Here, definitely postnatal things are not there. Bilirubin encephalopathy can be there. Meningitis can be there. Okay, so late onset sepsis can be there. So all those things are not there. Can there be natal issues? Because it's a third degree consanguineous marriage. Okay, natal issues can be there. So determining the onset is very important. When you go to the head circumference, the size of the head will tell you. Okay, so we will come to that once you present.
Okay,
that.
I want you to complete the diagnosis. What else is there, Usha? You stopped at spastic quadriplegia. Then, with involvement of vision, hearing issues are there for this child. Okay, and then this child has
failure to thrive
is there. Yeah, and then probably there is spasticity contracture the way he is describing the child with functional classification. What do you think is the functional classification of this child?
Heard of JMFCS?
Level 5 disease because it's dependent for all movements.
Okay, so it is. So that will complete your diagnosis. Okay, in history only you can arrive at everything. Okay, whatever you are going to say in the examination is only confirmation. So delay you have to say, that stiffness quadriplegia is what we have decided with some pseudobulbar involvement with vision, hearing affected, probably as you're saying small head also is there in this child with contractures, complications in terms of failure to thrive. Anything?
So recurrent URI or aspiration? What do you mean by recurrent URTIs?
Upper respiratory tract in me. That's
recurrent,
what.
What is the definition of recurrent URTI? You put URTI, not LRTI.
Yes, sir, because the SH, they give only history of cough and fever. Other than that, I ask for any hospital admissions as such, or any parental antibiotic, parental medications given.
Parental antibiotic. See, if I have my nursing home, I will give for everybody. That doesn't mean the child is having allergy.
What is the cutoff to call it as a lower respiratory? Okay, clinical cutoff.
Lower border of cricoid.
Lower?
Border of cricoid.
No. When do you say lower respiratory tract infection?
child should have tachypnea, no? So in your history, you should bring it out. Child is having tachypnea, and use of accessory muscles of respiration, like chest indrawing, all those things are there. Only then it becomes. Otherwise, it's URTA. Now, how will you distinguish whether they're repeated aspirations or upper respiratory? Definitely, there is no lower respiratory. Whatever you never said there was tachypnea, distress, nothing was there. How many URTAs are normal in a child? OPD question. This is
4 in a year.
So only 4.
2 to 8 per year.
You have any small kid at home? No.
Okay. Usha is saying 8.
8 to 10 episodes. Okay, is normal. Some if they are visiting daycare, going to school, and all, every month they can have. But there should be upper respiratory tract infection, settle in about 5 to 7 days of time, and intercurrent, child should be totally symptom free and child should be growing normal. If those criteria are met, that is normal.
Okay,
here maybe it's aspiration. Okay, so we'll just take that.
Okay, probably we'll another 20 minutes, we'll summarize the findings. Now that you have all heard this history, there are a lot of people in the audience who have not seen the child. Okay, I want one volunteer to tell me what is the expected parameters. You tell me what are the things this child could be having in examination. One in general physical examination, one in CNS. We will just ask Srivatsa to tell us later. I want one volunteer to tell me what are the things. Let us go
expected
to the
examination
expected findings. Examination findings, and then we just will prove, we'll see if we are right or wrong. Okay. In anthropometry, one volunteer to tell me what are the expected features in anthropometry? Dr. Priyanka can tell me. Usha?
Right. Her age, weight will be less.
Okay, we are expecting less weight. Okay, then.
We can't comment on the head because of the contractures, ma'am. Then head circumference will be less.
No, what do you expect? You would expect wasted, stunted, microcephalic field. All will be affected. Okay, yes. That is the expected thing. Unless he throws some surprises.
Okay.
Okay. Unless he's admitted with some infection, you expect hemodynamically him to be stable. When you go to general physical examination.
So can we confirm the anthropometry, Srivatsa? Okay. They are all saying it is both stunted and wasted and stunted with probable microcephaly. Right? They are right or wrong?
So why that's right, normal right, as we thought. How did you take height? How did you take height in this child?
We actually measured it as length because the child
okay.
cannot...
Okay, in length, how did you take length also in this child is the question.
From head this, to... This child is having issues, no?
Yeah, from head to heel.
Head to?
Heel.
Head to heel, how did you take?
So this guy is full straight, stiff.
Is he? Yeah, you said he's having contractures, right? How will you take length in this particular child?
No, the informant, they could slowly... release the flexion at the hip and the knee.
Okay. Any other comments? How probably can you take the length in the
suppose chest? This child is segmental having length. So segmental length you can take. So what you meant was, what do you mean by the, see, what is the information you are giving? Somebody can straighten up the, what does that mean? It's a dynamic contraction, isn't it? So there are two types of contractures, dynamic and static. Can anybody tell me what is the difference? What is dynamic contracture? What is static contracture?
Postgraduates are there here, right? They can tell you.
Srivatsa did something. No, you made it straight. So what does that mean?
That is a fixed or a dynamic contracture.
It is dynamic. See, dynamic means you take what are called R1 and R2. See, suppose my limb, see here. One jerk, I move till here. It stops. Then slowly I apply pressure, I can lengthen further. So there are two angles, R1 and R2. They are different. That means with force, we can extend the angle. That is a dynamic contractor. That's exactly what you have done. Normally, it was like this. You have applied pressure and you have made it straight. Okay. If it is fixed or static contracture, you cannot do anything. It is fixed there because of the tendinous contracture. Okay. So this has got a management issue. Okay, if it is a dynamic contracture, physiotherapy still works. You just have to do vigorous physiotherapy, still works. Whereas if it is static contracture where R1 and R2 are the same, then your physiotherapy is not going to help. Straight away, you're going to refer for the surgical corrections. You got the point, no? So that is the importance. Okay. Yes. So here from whatever you told, maybe. But once we come to CNS examination or general physical examination, you can tell that. So we have confirmed. So this child has a head circumference of 42 centimeter. Can anybody tell me what is the probable onset, time of onset of this disease now, looking at the head circumference? 42 centimeter is the normal head circumference at what age?
Don't know.
Others?
You are presenting a CP child, you don't know. What is the normal?
9 to 10 months.
42
9 months.
Oh my God. What is the normal head circumference at birth?
35 centimeters.
How does it grow from there?
First 3 months, 2 centimeters per. In next 3 months, 1 centimeter, and from 6 months to 1 year, 0.5 centimeter per month.
You know so much, then why you are telling wrong answers? 33 to 35 at birth. If I take as 33, lower side also, first 3 months it will grow 2 centimeter. It becomes 39. Next 3 months it grows 1 centimeter. That means it becomes 42. So 42 is around 6 months. Okay. After that, it will grow 0.5 centimeter per month till 1 year. That means by 1 year it becomes 45 centimeter. You got the thing, no? So it's around 6 centimeter. But what you also have to know is it is not born with that 42 centimeter and absolutely no growth after that. It is slowly growing, maybe not 2 centimeter in the first three months. It might have grown at 0.5 centimeter or whatever. Okay. So he is now 8 years. In 8 years, even if you assume a smallest of possible head, if it's grown small, means 7-8 centimeter, it could have grown. Okay. So most likely it tells you that the onset is antenatal. Okay. So you cannot totally blame the perinatal issues here. So that is why it is important. The smaller the head, more earlier the onset. Okay. Yes. So definitely not postnatal. Perinatals might have contributed for the smaller velocity of growth, but issue might have been prenatal. Okay. Yes. So that is something which is, you know, definitely it is going to tell. Can you have a CP with a normal head circumference? CP means always it is small head.
Most of the times it is small head, other than...
As a rule, it should be small head. If it is normal head, you have to revise your history, see if you are missing any other diagnosis. So CP, like presentation with normal head circumference is one indication for neuroimaging. Okay, otherwise you're not going to, this child, you're not going to do any neuroimaging.
Okay. Now, nowadays, it is indicated to know the type of CP. Okay. The point to note in your anthropometry is there is failure to thrive in this child. Okay. One point, whenever this is for postgraduate, if you cannot examine the, here in such a cases where there is spasticity, where you cannot stretch, either you can measure the segmental length and then add on, or there are formulas to calculate the height of the child. Okay. There is a, you have to measure the upper arms, upper length, multiply it into 4.3 plus 21.8. Or there is a formula to calculate the standing height in such cases. Okay. Please do read that and then measure. It is because this is a undergraduate. Okay. For you, you can just say a segmental length. Okay. But there are formulas where you can measure the upper limb and then extrapolate the height or the length of this child. Okay, that will be the thing. So they are right in anthropometry. Next, can one of you please summarize what are the
general physical examination?
General physical examination, what is expected?
See, till now, whatever we have guessed is correct. Srivatsa has not shown any surprises. General physical examination, what do you expect? Then we'll go to see. What do you expect in general physical examination? Obvious small head, which is there.
Kavya. Okay. Kavya, can you come in and answer?
Ma'am, microcephaly and there can be dysmorphic facies sometimes.
Yes.
Okay, do you expect in this child?
Do you expect in this child dysmorphic features?
Like partially open mouth or...
Okay, what else can be there? Okay, in a classical case of cerebral palsy, what other... Because you said open mouth, okay, then what else can be there?
Macroglossia can be there. There can be drooling of saliva.
Okay, then anything in the teeth?
Dental caries might be there.
Okay, there could be dental caries, enamel abnormalities can be there, or there could be overcrowding. Okay, lot of teething abnormalities can be there. There could be pooling of secretions. Then there is obvious small head. Anything else?
Short neck.
No, dysmorphism. That comes under dysmorphism, plus or minus. I'm not expecting. Okay, we'll just see if there is any dysmorphic features. Anything else?
Dysmorphic features may be there. It's a third there. Degree consanguinate marriage. We don't know.
Plus okay, or minus. Maybe. Apart from that, anything else?
Obvious small head, as madam said, then there can be caries, enamel defects, overcrowding of the defect. Then you might expect contractures in both the limbs, skeletal deformities like kyphoscoliosis. If it is bedridden, then you might find bed sores.
Okay.
Okay. So these things is what you're going to expect.
Okay. And obviously, going by the weight of this child, failure to thrive, probably the muscle mass, thinning of the muscle, wasting probably could be there in your general physical examination. So,
Maybe micronutrient deficiencies. Okay. Features. Okay. This also you have to look.
Yeah. For. What we did know, we told you what are the expectant things. On top of that, we have already told you what are the things to look for in case of a cerebral palsy. Okay. Mm. I think it is summarized over.
Now we will show. Yeah. Show us what is the examination, general physical examination finding.
Yeah, good. You have plotted the growth. I appreciate.
Mm. If there is microcephaly and appears conical in shape, face is dysmorphic, open mouth with crowded teeth, there is drooling of saliva, oral cavity.
Dysmorphic means what do you mean by dysmorphic?
In face, no? What are the dysmorphic features you expect?
Dysmorphic means what is there, you should write, no? Next. You cannot just say dysmorphic and leave.
Just because we said dysmorphic, we do not know. You should not say.
You said dysmorphic, you should explain further. What are all the dysmorphic features you can find in face? Can you name few?
What are the things which you expect and what was there in this child?
I am dysmorphic, you are dysmorphic.
No, it just did not appear like normal to me.
See, that's why I asked you there if there are any photographs. Okay, that's very...
That's because the baby has a small head. Okay, dysmorphic features means it should have very specific things like a synophris, okay, telecanthus, okay, epicanthic folds, low set tears, where there are specific definitions for these things. Only then you can call. Not because it is just looking small. Say it is, you see, any child who is having a significant microcephaly, it looks funny. It doesn't mean it is a dysmorphic child, isn't it?
Yes.
Okay.
So how did you say it was microcephaly? I will say it was craniosynostosis. How will you disprove that this child did not have craniosynostosis? Are you aware what is a craniosynostosis?
That sutures are fused.
Okay, so how will you prove to me that this was not craniosynostosis and it was microcephaly?
All craniosynostosis will have microcephaly? Extending whatever she said.
Okay.
All will have, okay, I'll give you options. All will have, most will have, very few will have microcephaly.
Don't know.
What, ma? Kavya? Kavya is a postgraduate, no?
Yes.
Kavya, I've given you three options. A child with craniosynostosis, all will have microcephaly, most will have microcephaly, or very few will have microcephaly. I've given you three options. Ray, PJ should answer, ma. What is the answers? Very few will have, because for head to be very small, all the sutures should close. And most of the times, what you're finding in, you know, craniosynostotic syndrome, your Crouzen's or whatever it is, Carpenter, very specific sutures are closed. That means it will compensate. If it is blocked here, it will outgrow somewhere else. So if you take the overall circumference, the head's shape might look abnormal, but the overall head size will be normal. Okay. Only if all the cranial sutures are closed, only then you are landing up in trouble. That is the child where you will need to do a linear craniectomy to release the pressure. That is a very, very small percentage of cases, unlike what most people think. Okay. This concept should be very clear.
Okay. So, craniosynostosis also, there is overriding of sutures. Okay. Unlike in microcephaly. Okay. So dysmorphic, no? Then you should be very specific. Low set ears, high arched palate. You should describe what is there. Okay. Yes. Okay.
Every individual you search, one or two will be there. Nobody is 100%.
There will be minor anomalies in most of us. Okay. So it could be there. Okay. Yes. So are we right in saying, are we in the track that general physical examination? Anything else? Any surprises?
You didn't mention any skeletal deformities, bed sores.
No, bed sores were not there. And
Okay, you mentioned.
No, you should specifically mention when you say bedridden patient. Na? That's so that examiner will know you looked for it.
Okay.
Yes.
And where are any contractures?
Okay, okay. Contractures is
the coronavirus deformity in left foot.
Scoliosis is there, adductor external rotator shoulders. Okay. You not mention contractures. You should mention specific contractures, where and what type of contracture. I've already discussed that. Okay. So whether they are, you know, dynamic contractures or static contractures, because it helps in your management. Fine.
Yes. Anyway, so there are contractures. There are skeletal anomalies as we described. Okay. Can just one of you
tell CNS
examination one. Dr. Priyanka, see? Dr. Ghazala, anybody can tell us? Cranial nerve examination, one of you say, one of you summarize, motor, quickly.
See, without Srivatsa, the child, we are getting the examination right.
So, history is so good that we are able to tell all the examination findings. Good, yeah. Yeah, Dr. Priyanka.
Higher mental function are, it means like speech delay and...
You won't do HMF in this child, no. This child is total zero, what he is telling. So, you're not wasting your time. You will go to
clinic. Okay, anyway, probably you will tell if it is alert or not. Okay, irritable, only such things you can comment on higher mental functions. Okay, then.
Contracture is present, posture and contracture is present and deformity, deformed child.
Yeah, that is there. We are talking about cranial nerve examination. Will you be able to tell us?
After higher mental function and posture, then cranial nerve examination. And first nerve involved because the vision is not present there.
And no, should tell nerve, relevant. You can't check the first nerve in this child. Ma. See, higher mental function is out, olfactory is out. Okay.
Second is involved. Third, fourth, and sixth are almost normal.
Okay.
Because you're not expecting any abnormality in 2, 3, 4, 5. 3, 4, 6.
Three, four, six.
Seventh may be involved, but in this child, no, not involved because only two of the slides are present.
Okay.
And 9, 10th is involved. 11 normal and 12 is also normal.
Okay. So she means to say she is telling us that second now probably is involved, and then she is saying all the lower motor, lower cranial nerves could probably be involved in this child. Is what is our guess? Okay. Yes.
3, 4, 6 could also be involved. Many of them will have strabismus.
Strabismus, quinn.
Okay. So you should specifically look for this thing.
Okay, yeah, we will see what are the cranial nerves.
Yes. Motor, anybody tell motor also? Together we will go. Motor, anybody, what is expected?
Usha, we left. Usha is not there. Kavya? Kavya? You are there?
Hello, ma'am.
Yeah, motor examination. Can you just
what is expected
in this child? We have only 10 minutes.
Wasting. Bulk wasting will be there.
Okay, good.
And power will be like less than 3 in all the forelimbs.
Okay.
And torn, there could be spasticity, hypertonia in all the forelimbs.
Okay.
And reflexes, there can be exaggerated reflexes and angle clonus might be there, but because of the contracture, it might be difficult to elicit.
What do you expect you tell? That
okay.
We will
okay.
See when
okay.
It says.
Yes. Okay.
Okay. Reduced bulk is there. Reduced power is going to be there. You're going to expect increased tone with exaggerated reflexes, with or without clonus, with upgoing plantars. Okay. This is what you're going to expect. So now you tell the examination findings. Then we will fine tune that little bit more. So, in second, what is the direct indirect reflexes present?
Yeah, tell us, Srivath.
Yes, cranial nerve 1 not tested, cranial nerve 2 and 3, the direct and indirect light reflex was positive, but an acute end field of vision not tested.
Was there any nystagmus?
No, no nystagmus. But the baby did not focus for when we moved anything.
Okay, I will tell you one thing. Okay, yes. What is this? I did something to sir.
Grimace. Cover and cover.
Huh?
We told.
Sir, what is that?
Meniscus reflex.
Meniscus reflex. Okay. So if you are not able to check, okay, the vision here, it is very difficult to do all your visual acuity tests. Okay, you just want to judge if this child is having. Okay, just bring in your hand, the blinking reflex when you bring in, that is a Meniere's reflex. That will tell you if this child is having vision or not. Simplest way to assess if this child is having vision, right?
If the child is not having light reflexes, what does it tell you?
Second cone is involved.
If everything is there, child is still blind. What does it tell you?
Cortical blindness.
Okay, yeah. So you should know that. Okay, all right, good. Okay, so what is positive findings you tell? Yes, full no. So yeah, that is not fully read out.
Okay, what are the positive things? One is second nerve, you said, is involved, then?
Yeah, cranial nerve 7, there are no facial expressions. However, corneal reflex is present.
No, only positive things you just summarize.
Cranial nerve 8 alerts only to loud sound.
Okay.
Cranial nerve 9 and 10, speech is absent. There is a gag reflex, there is difficulty in swallowing.
See, the UVL examination, you will say pooling of secretions, gag present, absent, exaggerated, whatever. See, facial also, you don't say facial expressions. Okay, so I might express myself or might not express. You are looking for, there is no evidence of facial palsy, you will say. Okay, yeah, like facial asymmetry. Okay, all those things. Yeah, that's all. So effectively, there is second nerve is involved, maybe hearing is involved. And then there is 9th, 10th nerve involvement is there, okay, which is expected.
Yeah, because lower cranial nerve and there is, so probably this is pseudobulbar palsy is there in this child. Yeah. Okay, next.
Go to motor.
Bulk reduced in all limbs. Midterm and thigh circumference are equal bilaterally, measuring 17 and 26 centimeter respectively. Tone, all limbs are stiff. Range of passive movements is reduced and resistance is increased. Power, there no voluntary movements.
Okay, just hold on. Go back. Just okay. See, suppose all limbs are stiff, you are told. Will there be any differential stiffness by different groups of muscles? See, for an undergraduate, I will take it. Postgraduates are also I'm asking. So you have to talk about the groups of muscles. See, initially, I told you changing diaper, that is adductor group. So like that, in a case of spastic CP, what are all the groups of muscles in lower limb and upper limb, which are preferentially affected. You got my question, no? Like one, I told you, adductor groups are involved. Like that, what are the groups of muscles which are affected? No, it's important.
No, we will only summarize.
Okay, see, adductors are involved, hip flexors are involved. That's why, they will keep like that. And then there are hamstrings are involved. Then there is gastrocnemius. That is why, you are having that equinus deformity. So these are the four groups of muscles in the lower limbs which are involved. In the upper limbs, again, there is adductors of the shoulder, internal rotation. Then there is pronation, wrist flexion. Then there is your thumb, adductor and flexors. That is why the posture goes like that. So these are the groups of muscles. If you delineate this and further prove, the examiner will be more impressed. Okay. Then of course, your DTRs are going to be brisk. If it is possible to elicit without contractures or anything, you should elicit the clonus, knee clonus, ankle clonus, both. This child, I think, was having contractures, so it was difficult. Involuntary movements, you have to see. So now, there is increased tone, you said. In that, what increased tone you have to tell? There are three different things. One is spasticity, second is dystonia, third is a lead pipe rigidity. Okay. So how will you distinguish all three?
In spasticity, there is the faster you stretch, the more is the resistance.
Okay, what is so that?
Velocity dependent, okay, like clasp knife. So you keep moving, initially is the resistance, then it gives way. Whereas lead pipe, it is uniform. And lead pipe, if you keep repeatedly doing it, gives way, it becomes all right. Okay, whereas the spasticity persists with the same thing. And what about dystonia?
There will be involuntary movements, choreothetic.
Dystonia means there are twisting movements leading on to posturing. So they will do like this, okay, retrocollis, opisthotonus, like that, things can be there. That's so, more of an inspectory thing rather than, you will do any maneuvers and
things. Dystonia to see spasticity to be elicited or done.
You got the point. No? All these are increased tone conditions. If you just tell increased tone, maybe at UG will accept, but if you can tell spasticity, rigidity, whatever. Can this child have hypotonia also?
Any, this is for others as well.
PGs.
Can there be hypotonia in this child? Is it possible?
Hypotonia.
Not initially.
Now at this point, we are asking.
So in a CP child, in a given CP child, you can have all the types of tone abnormalities in a single child. Most of them will have a central hypotonia. If you look at the truncal muscles, they'll be hypotonic. You put the child up, it will go. Axial,
there is axial hypotonia with peripheral hypertonia. Okay, if you had carefully examined this child does not have head control, right? Neck control, there is flapping. I don't know if you've done 180 degree examination. If you start examining the child, when you lift up this child, when you make the sit child, there is axial hypotonia will be there for
so
this
it will
child.
Be more okay? rounded neck.
You more rounded, have. Okay. We are not sure if Srivatsa is understanding.
They will have central hypotonia, central muscles, back muscles, paraspinal muscles, all of them can be hypotonic, whereas the limb muscles can be hypertonic in a same child. Okay, in a same child you can have. So then you need not be surprised with that. So this is one thing which you should have. So that's why you should check for all the different things.
Okay, see, and preferably all these at all levels of you just generalized. Okay, every examination should be done at different joints. Okay, it could be power, it could be your tone. Okay, whatever.
Somebody has asked, what is the importance of clonus? Clonus only means that the reflexes are too much exaggerated. You are scoring for the DTRs, no? In that, the last is the clonus.
That is there. Here, what we are trying to say is if it is extremely, there is spasticity contracture, we might not be able to elicit is what...
Because it has to move like this. No? Okay. If there are contractures, it will not... It's difficult to elicit.
Difficult is what we do. Okay. Yeah. Okay, next. Srivatsa, you are there? Freeze Agidhyan.
Yes. And examination findings.
Srivatsa?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, any other positive findings, examination?
Am I audible?
Babinski is positive. Okay.
Yes, superficial reflex. Babinski is positive bilaterally. Abdominal reflex is exaggerated. Deep tendon reflexes, knee jerk and ankle jerk exaggerated with clonus. Biceps, triceps and supinator reflexes are exaggerated.
So all are exaggerated basically. Okay, two clonus are there. If you have clonus, they are two types. One is ill-sustained, another is well-sustained. Ill-sustained means it will do only a few times. It will not persistently keep doing like this. Okay. And the moment you commit for a clonus, examiner is going to ask you to demonstrate. So if it is not very consistent, please don't commit for that. Okay. Yes. Because if you don't get, examiner gets, you might say, okay, I missed it. If you commit and you are not able to demonstrate, you will be wrong.
Yes.
Right?
Okay.
Stance gate in this child, you cannot do. Anything else? Positive other systems, anything?
No, sensory system, there is response to pain.
Anything
but
positive, you tell. Nothing positive, no? Now you tell me what is the final diagnosis. No surprise,
Cerebral palsy, GMFCS level 5 with global developmental delay and undernourishment.
Okay. You missed out so many other things. No, this child
has microcephaly, vision and hearing effect is there. Okay, feeding issues are there in this child.
You should enlist all the things.
Okay, all
seizures
whatever.
Is not there. Only newborn seizures it had. No, that's all.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So now already we have discussed quadriplegia, diplegia, another variety is double hemiplegia. Okay, there also all four limbs can be involved. Okay, so that concept I think is very clear now. Okay. So many times it is a mixture. Okay. It's not like very clear cut, as I told you. They can have a dyskinetic component also. They can have, as we told, axial hypotonia also. But what is dominant you're going to present, that is going to be accepted. Like in this child, spastic quadriplegia. All right. One, you have to also have to mention what is the probable etiology, all that. What is the probable etiology? Multifactorial. Perinatal definitely is there.
I can think of birth asphyxia, but then...
Perinatal definitely is... No. That's what I'm telling. Etiology, probable perinatal is there. Natal is also there because you have to look at the head size. Okay? It is multifactorial. Okay? So, you cannot pinpoint at one thing and say. Onset, looking at the head size, so onset is much earlier. Okay? And consanguinity is there.
Okay. So I think Priyanka wanted to know efferent and efferent for Meniere's reflex. See, Meniere's reflex is basically what we told you to, it's a part of vision. Okay. It will just tell you the visual pathway is intact or not. That is because we said we cannot test visual acuity in that child. Okay.
Efferent is your optic now only. You are seeing. Okay. Efferent is You are fifth now, because okay,
probably
so not fifth, no, seventh now, because there is going to be closure. Of the eye.
Okay, you could take it, but it is not a classical,
it's not like the regular
reflexes. What we are talking, we just told you that you could do a Manet's reflex as a part of your visual acuity. Okay, okay,
how will you manage this, child?
Quickly briefly. Tell me in 1 or 2 minutes, we'll wind up. Okay, how will you manage?
Okay, physiotherapy.
No, what is, yeah,
muscle relaxants, like okay.
So in different age groups you have different priorities for a cerebral palsy. This is an 8-year-old child. Going by that, what are all your priorities and how will you plan your treatment?
Physiotherapy is for what? Physiotherapy is give for what?
For increasing range of movements.
So reduce the stiffness, increase in the range of movement. That is what you do in early, okay? Especially 2 to 5 years of age group. If you do it well, your other problems, orthopedic problems, become less. What is occupational therapy? What is the occupation of this child? What so is the occupational therapy? You put it there, I'm asking.
He's able to do things which need for sustaining his life.
Maybe. Then what is occupational therapy? Then what is vocational training?
Others can pitch in quickly.
At least broad headings, when you put it, it should not know. The occupational therapy is making the child self-sufficient. Okay. He should be able to take bath. He should be able to eat his breakfast. He should be able to dress up himself. He should be able to go to bathroom and come. Okay. So personal care, that means he's not dependent on third party. That is your occupational therapy. The next one is, depending on how much is trainable, you can do a vocational training or a non-formal school or a formal school. That, as the time goes, you will take a call. So if the child is not speaking, you will give speech therapy for everybody, or you will decide whom to give speech therapy. He's not speaking, no. Give speech therapy. Not speaking, give speech therapy. Everybody will speak. What is language? What is speech? I'm just giving you a very basic concept, because you're using this. What is language? What is speech?
Not aware.
Not now. Are we all speak? We all know language. My mother tongue, your mother tongue. But we don't know. So language, okay, is what? There are two types in this. One is expressive language. Another is receptive language. Receptive is what is our understanding. Okay, for example, I ask a child to get the mobile phone. He will get it. That means he's understanding. He may not be able to speak. Expressive is when he speaks. Verbal expressive language is called speech. Okay. So that means there is also non-verbal expressive speech. Okay. That means a child understands. Somebody has got a biscuit packet. He understands. But he doesn't know, give me that biscuit. That is speech. He doesn't say that. He can just point and show, give me that. So that is non-verbal expression. You're getting the point, no? So first criteria to go for the speech therapy, the receptive language should be good. Okay. So then how do you know his understanding? He should have non-verbal expressive speech. That means he's pointing, he asked him to get something, he's getting all that he's doing. Only if these two criteria are met, then to take care of the motor coordination, he will spend for the speech therapy.
Yeah, his hearing should be all right.
Yeah. Only if his hearing is normal, he'll develop receptive language. Okay, otherwise, he's not going to develop. You got it, no? So if it's a total zero, you're not going to send him to speech therapy. Okay.
Yes.
So some basic concepts I told you, then vocational thing and other thing. Then you should know when to use muscle relaxants, okay, when to send for orthopedic things and all that. So physiotherapy, muscle relaxants in case of dynamic contractures, fixed contractures will go for the surgical corrections.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so what we are trying to tell you is at each age group, say if it is an infancy, what probably is your priority is to make sure you give an infant stimulation, proper position, make sure that spasticity is not there for this child. As the child goes on to childhood, in this particular child, you want to make sure that you minimize the spasticity and add on to other, if this child is a candidate to give a botulinum toxin or any other medications. As 5 years and beyond, please screen for other skeletal abnormalities, hip screening to be done. And is this child, if this child is having severe contractures, does this child require a surgical management? Any orthosis, braces should be there. In adolescent, other behavioral issues. So each age group, there are different priorities for us to differently manage. Okay. So that is what?
And everything should fit in the broader picture of the child. If it's a bedridden child, they want to release a small gastrocnemius contracture, it doesn't make sense.
Okay, provided everything.
If you are going to achieve something out of it, then only you should do. For example, if there is a windswept deformity where they will have hip dislocation, it can be painful. Then even in a bedridden child, you will do. Otherwise, you'll keep howling. Okay, you have to give comfort for the child. So what are you going to achieve by doing a particular thing? You should ask that question, then only you should. Okay, if it is useful either for the caretaker or for the child, then only you should. Otherwise, no. Fine.
So, okay, can we...
Anything else you guys want to know or we will...
Yeah. Sir, kindly repeat the group of muscle involvement upper and lower limbs once more.
Okay, lower limb, adductor. Lower limb, adductor. Okay, hip adductors, hip flexors, hamstring muscles, gastrosoleus. Okay, this is the four important groups. And there will also be internal rotators of the hip if you carefully examine. Five groups you can take. In the upper limb, adductors of the shoulders, internal rotation, okay, then flexors of the elbow, and then there is pronation, then there is wrist flexion, then adductor, pollicis, some flexion and adduction. Okay, these groups of muscles are involved. Okay, so.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Okay. So anything else, Srivatsa? Something you understood? It was a good presentation for an undergraduate. Probably a little more refined is what I would have expected. Otherwise, it was
only thing which I was grossly disappointed was not knowing the head circumference. That is not acceptable even for a UG. Okay,
they will
you
know.
You should know when you are presenting a microcephaly case.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. There are things which we categorize in as an exam into three things. Things which you must know. That means there is we need not pardon you if you don't know that. That was one such thing. Second thing is things which which are good to know. That means a little advanced. That if you don't answer that, you won't be penalized. Then things which are nice to know, like very advanced. Okay, that like to give you gold medal, not to give you gold medal kind of things. So must know, you should know. Few good to things to know things also you should know.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. Most important is he smiled and presented. That is what mattered to us.
And don't learn nice to know things at the cost of must know things. That is what most kids do. They will tell ultrasound abdomen, MRI findings, everything, but they won't know what is spasticity, rigidity. That is not acceptable.
Okay.
Fine.
Yes.
So it was a good presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am.
And thank you for all the active participation of all the other undergraduates and postgraduates. Okay. Yeah. Nandini, can we wind up?
Yeah, ma'am. I'll conclude the session now.
Yeah.
It was indeed a comprehensive clinical class. The discussion was very useful to us. Thank you so much, Chidananda sir and Nagalata ma'am, for teaching and guiding us. We're ever grateful to you. We need your support throughout. It was a great effort by our presenter, Mr. Srivatsa Acharya. We could learn a lot because of your well-prepared presentation. We also thank all the participants who were enthusiastically answering and were actively involved. Thank you, one and all.
Okay.